If you've got your Bible with you this morning, with me to the book of Judges, chapter 16, verse 19. The book of Judges, chapter 16, verse 19. So I am touching on a topic called how to keep your anointing right to the end. It's one thing for you to know Jesus Christ, and it's another thing for you to know, for you to be fully imparted, and people will get excited by the Spirit of God. And as soon as the Holy Spirit comes and descends on you, you realize, you're no longer the same person. You are now a different person. And out of the anointing, you do a lot of things before God. You become bold. You become powerful. You stand up in places that you never thought you can actually speak. You never thought you could speak in a such a way where you can articulate your opinion or your argument or whatever it is. So the anointing carries in your personal life in a such a way that you do realize that God puts you in different places that you feel before God that you're not even meant to be in that spot, not to be meant to be in the place. But however, a lot of us will start off well. Dr. Frank Holgren used to say to me, it's easy to start off in the ministry, but not easy to finish in the ministry. Everyone starts off ministry. Anyone can start off ministry, but no one seems to finish the ministry because there is temptation, because there will be people who will come and, people will come and give you an insult, people will come and say this, and ministry sometimes can take a toll on a person's life, and eventually you will say, I don't want to serve God in any way, form, or shape. I think only just a week ago in California, a young pastor with a church of 5,000 people, he committed suicide. And so every month in the United States, now it's becoming very common. Pastors are committing suicide. At the end of it, you need to realize and understand that pastors are simply human beings. And so they are doing their level best, and they're doing everything you could, but the people who are behind the pulpit will get burnt out. And so my point is, if I'm not having a go against this pastor or anyone. If anything else, my sympathy goes towards that man. And, he would have left his wife and his children. It's become a common phenomenon in the United States that there are pastors dying simply because it's easy. It's easy to grow a church, 5,000. The more, the higher, the bigger the church grows, the bigger the headaches are. Do you realize that? Sometimes a church on a smaller scale, people become very, numbers driven. It's not a bad thing because, Bible says on the day when, in the book of Acts says on the day when the Holy Spirit comes in, descends, everyone speaks in the tongues. Bible says in chapter 2, book of Acts, it says 3,000 people were added into the church of Jesus Christ. And they'll say, whoa, wow, that's a great number. So mega church has always been there ever since when the baptism of the Holy Spirit took place. But then to deal with every single man, every single woman, one day one person will say, hey, Pastor Rich, I love you. Next day the same person will say, hey, Pastor Rich, I hate you. And so sometimes you will say, I don't want to be in the ministry. Would you agree with me? There was, in my seminary, I don't want to mention the name. In my seminary, there was a wonderful young man. He became the ducks of our seminary. In other words, everything he did, every 4 years Bible college of training he did, every subject he did, he received distinctions. I mean, I got some distinctions. I'm not an all distinction. I'm more an average kiddo, like, B's and C's. More or less B's are the common ones. A's are here and there, I'll get it. But this lad got A, everything A plus. So he became the ducks. But then somewhere along the line, somewhere about 20 years ago, I was going down with a mate of mine and to Crown Casino to have a dinner or to have a lunch. In fact, to have a lunch. And all of a sudden, I could see this man was tending the garden and he was looking after the vincas. The vincas, those beautiful plants which has got nice, beautiful flowers. I looked at him from the back, and I want to change the name. And I looked at him in the back, and I realized this is John. John, whom I actually studied alongside in the same seminary, but he was 3 years senior than I was in the seminary. And I said, hey, John. And he turned around. He looked at me. He looked at me and said, hey, Reg, how are you? I said, what are you doing looking after the gardens? I thought you started a church. He said, I quit from the ministry because I could not handle people anymore. You see, it's easy to start in the anointing. It's not easy to last in the anointing. I just want to say this. There's this special man. This is one of my son. He's come all the way. His name is Joel Knox. I'll embarrass him a little bit. He's one of my sons. Come all the way from New Zealand. He will be here for a while with us. And so just get to know him. He's a great, great, great guy. I'm bringing his pastor, I think in the month of November, another 2 months' time, I'm going to bring him, Pastor Waha. He's a great man of God, and he's a Samoan. I'm going to bring him. We're going to use him in this place with the young adults and a few other things that I've got, and also in the services as well. So get to know him. Joel is a great bloke. Don't mess around with me. He is my right-hand bodyguard. If you mess around with me today, he will chuck you off wherever he wants to. So, can we look at the scripture? He looked after me and my wife and my kids when we were in New Zealand in the month of July. He drove me everywhere. Judges chapter 16 verse 19. You see, lullaby. Can you see the word lull has come? Lullaby. Look at this. Then she lulled him to sleep on her knees and called for a man and had him shave off of the 7 locks of his head. Then she began to torment him and his strength left him. It was interesting. At about maybe 10 years ago, a lady kept on coming to this church. Every day she would come to the church, and before I start off, she would corner me and she would take me aside. She would say, "Have you been praying for my husband? Have you been praying for my husband?" I said, "I've been praying for your husband." I said, "You know, I haven't got a breakthrough, but every time I come to your church, every single person has got a breakthrough. But my husband doesn't seem to have a breakthrough at all, and I don't seem to have a breakthrough in my marriage." And one day I cried. I said to God, "Is there something that I'm praying that I'm not praying rightly so? You know, why is her husband not changing? This poor lady has been tormented in this marriage for the last 18 years. Why aren't you not doing it?" One day the Holy Spirit appears to me. "Let me take you now to where I'm going to take you." He takes me into her kitchen, into her house, transported in the spirit, went into her house. And he did not take me to a lounge room, did not take me into the front room, did not take me into the backyard. He takes me straight inside the kitchen, and there is this pantry. I said to the Holy Spirit, have you brought me into a house to look at the pantry? Watch, I'm going to open the door for you and watch very carefully. He opens the door up. I could see the noodles. I could see the spaghetti. I could see all the above. But there is one cricket bat which has been shorn off really well. I said to the Holy Spirit, "Why is this cricket bat is in the pantry?" I said, "Does she play cricket?" No, she does not play cricket. Every twice or three times a night, she will use this cricket bat to hit her husband. People say to me, there's always violence, towards women. But let me tell you this one, the violence can be on the other side of the coin too. Let me make it very, very clear. And so the next time she comes over here, "Pastor H, have you?" And this was one of those ladies who can be kind of passive aggressive. And she knows God, but then she puts me, and she's not part of this church, by the way. She comes from another church. I like how people come from other churches. They'll put a demand. I said to myself, "Have you put your demand on your own pastors? Oh, my pastor can't move in the giftings. Ask your pastor to go and fast and pray and ask for the giftings." "Oh, my pastor won't do that." Then it's not my problem then. So this time this lady comes up to me. She said, "Are you praying?" Again, you can pick up this passive aggressiveness. God said to me, "I think you need to tell her right now." I said, I said to this lady, "Sweetie, I just want to let you know you got a beautiful house." She starts to look at me very strangely. "You got a beautiful house. And I saw in your kitchen wonderful things, nice ornaments, nice pans, all are hanging out." She said, "You've never come to my house. Don't worry about it. Let me tell you something else. But I saw in your pantry there's a cricket bat inside there. What's a cricket bat doing in the pantry?" She looks, "I'm very busy right now." She's gone. Never saw her. I'm still waiting. It's been 10 years now. I'm still waiting for her to return back. 10 years later, I haven't seen her. "Who told you about this cricket bat?" I said, "My Spirit of God showed me there's a cricket bat. You're using this cricket bat on someone. Am I right to say that?" "I'm sorry, Pastor Rich. I'm very busy right now. I gotta go." You see, my point is, I just want to let you know. I just want to encourage you, and I just want to let you know. The scripture says here, then she lulled him to sleep on her knees and called for a man and had him shave off the 7 locks of his head. Then she began to torment him. So I brought that story because that lady tormented the husband over and over again on a cricket bat. Three times in a week, the cricket bat will be used to hit on his shoulders. She never came back. I want to say this to you right now. You can be sitting under the anointing of God, right? Under the anointing of God. You will raise your hands. You will say hallelujahs, all the right words. But then at the same time, you could torment your husband. You can torment your children. You can torment your wife. You can torment your mom. You can torment your dad. You can torment every single person you want. I'm telling you right now, it is not the right anointing. You see, when the anointing comes, God comes and puts a conviction in you. And if you're going to start off in this journey with God, God will start to speak to you in your personal life. And when God starts to speak to you in your personal life, certain things will say, don't do this. Don't touch this. Don't speak like that. Don't try to, pull a wool over her. Don't try to pull a wool over him. It's always what I call the Holy Spirit will have a check and balances. You see, the problem with young Samson, he started off very well. An angel speaks to his mom and dad that your son is going to deliver Israel from the Philistines. And from day dot, when he came out of his mother's womb, anointing was already there. The Spirit of God was there. Who is the Spirit of God? The Holy Spirit. But here, he gets enticed by this woman. Look at this. She lulled him to sleep. In other words, she would have sang to him to sleep on her knees. And so right at this moment, someone is trying to take the anointing off. People can become very jealous within your family. And when they start to see that you're doing very well, when they start to see that you're getting promoted, when they start to see you're buying brand new car, when they start to see that you're updating new house, they're never happy with you. Do you agree with me? Because there is something beautiful about the anointing of God. When you stand and when you remain in God, God starts to bless you, bless you, bless you. But people won't like it. What will they do? They will lull you to go to sleep. So while you have been lulled to go to sleep, they will steal everything out of your hands. Can I ask of you, there are some things you should tell to a person and don't say everything about your life. Your standards will be compromised. They will use your story and they will sell your story to someone else. Right? So I'm looking at this scripture right at this moment. And so we are looking at one thing. The anointing could only survive if you remain humble. Number one point. You see, one of the things is Samson realized he had something powerful, something special, but then he never knew how to really humble himself. He tells everything to this lady to the point where the scripture says, then she began to torment him. Would you agree? It's in the New Testament. Who torments you and I? The devil. The evil one torments. But this is a very strong word. Could you see that? Delilah is not operating in the anointing. Delilah is operating out of a carnal, fleshly nature to the point, it says over here, then she began to torment him. Only evil spirits will torment you. So her spirit in itself, it clearly starts to show that Delilah's spirit is not the right spirit. It has got a spirit to torment you. Some people you'll come across, they will try to torment you. They'll try to say, you're not good at this, you're not good at that, you're not good at this, you're not good at that. They torment you. I was in United Arab Emirates, Dubai. I'm going back at about 16 years of age. And I was a young pastor. I got called by the Australian churches, expats, all Aussie expats. They called me in and I started to speak. And as I started to preach, and there was a young lady sitting at the back. I called her up and she came up in the front and I gave her the word of knowledge, what God said to me. After that, she goes back to her senior pastor and she says to the senior pastor, everything that this young man, I was about 34, 35 years of age, very young. Everything that this young pastor said, every word of knowledge, every prophecy is completely lies, bogus. So I felt sorry for the pastor. The pastor comes up to me and the pastor says, everything you said, Pastor Rich, was lies. I said, I'm so sorry, Pastor. And he says to me, that lady is demanding your attention tomorrow afternoon at 5 p.m. She wants to see you. 35 years of age. Never been a pastor. I'm an itinerant traveling evangelist. So I've got a credentials and ordination from the Assemblies of God in this country. And never held as a senior pastorship. And this pastor is starting to freak out because I found out that this family tithes quite heavily, just to let you know that. And she's panicking because she and the entire family are going to leave the church. I said to the Holy Spirit, why did you do this to me? This is why I told you, I don't want to come to Dubai. He said to me, shut up and just listen to what I'm going to do. He's got a way of saying to me all the time, just shut up. He knows my character. So finally the pastor came, and I could see the pastor's almost like in tears. Churches are interesting because some families will come into a church and, you know, they believe in giving, but sometimes some churches in some families, when they do give a lot, they tend to control the pastor as well. And it's a very sad state of affairs. I give a lot into this church, but when I give it, I'm giving it to God. I'm not giving it to any one of you guys. I'm giving it to God. To be honest with you, with all modesty, with all humility, the biggest person who gave into this church, it's my wife and I, $580,000. I still got a mortgage. But I don't tell all the time. I just say once in a while, 580 grand I gave to this church. But, I'm giving it to God because I want to mention up in heaven. When I go up there, everything's been built up for me. And that's what I did, what I did. And so this pastor is like, he's driving, in Dubai, and he's, starting to shed tears. And I just did not know what to say. So we finally, with fear and trepidation, we went into the home, sat down, and the ladies, and the worst part is, the lady's husband decided to record the entire thing. Back in those days, was cassette tapes. And he recorded. Every single word was written on an A4 size paper. And he reads word after word after word, sentence after sentence. He says, everything you said, it's a lie. It's not true. The senior pastor is looking at me. I'm a 35-year-old kid. I'm just listening to him. I said, my Lord, what do you want me to say? Just tell her that you have done a mistake. I said, my God, you showed me all this in a TV screen. Yeah. I showed you all that in the TV screen. Just tell them that you've stuffed it up. You're a young man. Just throw yourself that you're a young man. You've stuffed it up. So after great, they just accused me, kept on accusing me for 30 minutes, trying to tell me I'm a charlatan, false prophet, all the above. I just withstood all this, and the pastor is, not breaking down, but he's trying to handle, trying to contain, what we call damage control. But eventually, I just said to the couple, I said, you know what? I am so sorry. I've stuffed everything up, and I am so sorry. I will do my level best the next time when I start to pray for people. But I am so sorry that this thing has happened. I have really stuffed it up. And you should hear that time, at that moment, you could almost hear someone who drops a pin, you could pick it up. Everything went silent. And the lady who accused me and the husband who accused me, husband and wife accused me, within 5 minutes later, they changed their tune. No, you're not a charlatan. I said, you just said to me, I'm a charlatan. I'm a false prophet. You just said that to me. Finally, 20, 40 minutes later, 50 minutes later, they said, we did not like you telling our entire story on a public forum. Because do you know who we are? I said, I don't know who you are. We got prestige. We got dignity. We are someone powerful in this church. You decide to bring this thing out like a gossip podium. People are surprised who we are, what we are. And so we decided to come and to bring bogus allegations against you. They broke down. They cried. They asked my forgiveness. God said to me, didn't I tell you, Rich? When I tell you to shut up, there's a reason I ask you to shut up. I'll always vindicate your name. That lady literally tormented me. And the husband was literally tormented by the wife. And he wrote everything under duress because of the wife. You see, Delilah's spirit is a spirit which can torment you. If you come across a spirit of Delilah, please try to keep away. But the most important of all, you need to start to pray for Delilah's spirit. The spirit of Delilah will always torment you. But can I also bring moderation in this topic? There are men and women who will come into this church. Pastor Rich, she's got Jezebel. Pastor Rich, she's got Absalom. Please don't make name calling. There'll always be all kinds of spirits. But what is your job? What is your responsibility? To pray for them, to break the spirit at the back of them. I prayed for that lady. She broke down. She cried. She says to me, there's something wrong with me, Pastor Rich. I could have told, yeah, there is something wrong with you. I didn't say that. I said, can I have your hands? I'm going to break this. And she broke and she manifested in a demonic power. You see what I'm trying to say this to you? Try not to look out for people. Try not to have, you know, I look at Luke. Oh, Luke has got, you know, this evil spirit. Now, what sort of spirit? Oh, it must be a spirit of, you know, Absalom. Oh, I look at this lady. Oh, there's a spirit of, you know, spirit of Rebecca. And so people like to have give people profiles. Don't do that. If God does shows you a profile, I want you to pray into that person, intercede for that person, and to see a breakthrough. You see, it's easy to give names. Am I right to say easy to give a name calling, a label on anyone? But what are you going to do about it? That's the biggest responsibility God will ask you. The second point, can I ask of you to come to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 20. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 20. And so when you look at this very scripture, scripture tells me over here, 16:20, and if it is, oh, this could be completely wrong. Sorry, no. Can I have, can I have 1 Samuel chapter 16, no, 1 Judge, sorry, the book of Judges, sorry, the book of Judges 16, verse 20. This is my mistake, please forgive me. The book of Judges 16 verse 20. I am so sorry, son. And so it says here, and she said, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. So he awoke from his sleep and said, I will go out as before at other times, shake myself free. But he did not know the Lord had departed from him. He did not know the Lord had already departed from him. And so, starting with the anointing of God, how could you make the anointing to last right to the end of your life? This young man has lost the anointing. So what is the anointing? It's the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, that you and I are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Do you realize the Holy Spirit can depart from you? It certainly departed from Samson's life. I want to encourage you, and I just want to let you know right now that, you know, if you are going to lead a life of anointing, if you are going to serve God, if you're going to become the mom and dad in your family, if you are going to look after your husband, if you are going to look after your wife, I'm saying to you, nothing can operate or function without having the power of the anointing. But at the same time, let me also make it very clear, when your family comes against you, when your employer comes against you, when your children comes against you, you might say some things, derogatory things you might say. The Holy Spirit will say to you, I no longer find this young man, or I no longer find this young woman pleasing enough for me to live in him. You see, right at this moment, Samson compromised. Samson diluted the gospel. Samson diluted the standards of God. By now, by scripture says earlier on, verse 19, that he was lulled on the knees of Delilah. And the scripture says very clearly, Delilah tormented him right at this moment. And she says this, and she said, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. So he woke up from his sleep and said, I will go out as before. Never ever think that, you know, because you are very tight with God, just because you are tight with God, just because you are very close with God, there might be something that you might do. One day you might find the Holy Spirit will depart from you. Can I ask you this part, not to
right
this?
Let's go through right at this moment. Come with me to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 19. The book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 19.
No doubt there will be some complaints on Facebook where and how everything went quiet.
In the New Testament, a believer can quench and grieve the Holy Spirit. And so, listen over here. Scripture says, 1 Thessalonians 5:19, do not quench the Spirit. Do not quench the Spirit. And so, what did young Samson did? He quenched the Spirit. And whose Spirit? The Holy Spirit. The moment you quench the Holy Spirit, he will walk away from you. And you lose, and you've all virtually you've lost the absolute total anointing.
I want to encourage you, and I just want to let you know right at this moment, if you are in the anointing, you've started the anointing very well, finish the anointing right to the end of your life.
Don't quench him. He does not like to be told off. He does not like to be instructed. He will tell you what to say, what not to say, when to speak, when not to speak. He will start to guide you and direct you. Can I have the next scripture? Ephesians chapter 4 verse 30. The book of Ephesians chapter 4 verse 30. And so if you were to look at, again, something to do, it says, till chapter 4 verse 30, son. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Do not, what it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. I find every church, and including this church, I think people can become very protective of their turf. You know what's turf? Is when I say, Joel, could you run this ministry? And I'll say, Laura, could you run this ministry? I will tell this lady in the pink, could you run this ministry? Now all of a sudden, each person will become very protected about a turf. Each time when I see this, the Holy Spirit will say to me, I'm grieving for my people. I said, I too am grieving. The ministry should be open, accessible, because every ministry has got people who are well-to-do, and then you've got broken people. So what I call it, or what we call it in this country, we call it class warfare. I got a certain class, Lucas has got a certain class, you know, Detective Columbo has got a, has got a certain class. And so we look at, okay, she is well dressed up, she will be in my class. She is okay, I don't like polka dots. People look at you, what sort of shoes are you wearing? What sort of watch are you wearing? And then they'll gravitate to you. But if you see Detective Columbo with, with the aviators class, loopy loop, woo-hoo. You know what I mean? How people will make, hey, there's a judgment call. I handle that every single day. And pastors will ask me, why is it, Pastor Rich? I said, as long as you've got broken people, this is what we do. It's sad, isn't it? Within, you run this department ministry, you run that department, and all of a sudden, Luke will say, Pastor Rich, this is not how I'm going to tell, and so all of a sudden, Tommy will tell me, Pastor Rich, I want to join with Luke. Luke says, no, he's not acceptable. Right in front of me, the Holy Spirit will weep. Sad how we see people, people ain't perfect. They all have got their old foibles. We all have got foibles. And in the midst of all this, we have got this class warfare within the Church of Jesus. That's why someone said, the Church of Jesus Christ is still under construction. Huge construction. Jesus walked with a taxpayer. Jesus also sat down with a prostitute. Am I right to say that? I have sat down with prostitutes. I've also sat down with multimillionaires. They will come and sit down. I said, sweetie, you're doing something. Don't do that again. And she will break down. She will cry. Once she's gone, a multi-millionaire will come in. I said, you are doing something with the stocks and exchange, and you're manipulating. He'll break down and cry. Sin is sin. Sad, isn't it? How we've got different people, different class warfare. This is where I pulled in. This is where Len will fit in. This is where Chess will fit in. Why? Because Chess speaks very fluently. Len, rather Oka Aussie. Adam, right? And all of a sudden, you're not invited to my home. Because why? He's an Oka Aussie. And why? Because Chess is rather refined English. I know that. I go to different nations, different countries. They judge you through this way. This church, any church will judge you that way. But the Holy Spirit says, I'm sad, Rich. This is not how I wanted my church. And so, so this is a church, we have got, both end of the spectrums. People are extremely broken, and then people are doing well, but not extremely broken. Somewhat of brokenness. And so we tend to put a lot of pressure. You need to become like me. No. You become like the image and the likeness of Jesus Christ. You see, I just want to say this. There's a lot of broken people. We need to rescue a lot of broken people. Jesus came for the broken. Jesus never came for the rich. Do you know that? He always came for the poor. Yet there are churches in this country or any other country, we only go for middle income earners or the higher upper echelon, the higher income earners. Jesus never came. Jesus came for all income earners. sad, breaks the heart of God. Am I right? And so that's why I say it's quench. So the last point, staying true to the anointing. Can I have 1 John chapter 2, verse 27? The book of 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. But the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you. But as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things is true and is not a lie, and just it has been taught to you, you will abide in him. You will abide in him. Stay true to the last lot of anointing. God will send you interesting people. I have three categories of people. People are completely broken, dysfunctional, and then people who are middle income earners, and then people are higher income earners. I got no class. I don't want to have class. Jesus never had class. Jesus only had one thing. Can I have his name or her name written in the book of life? That's what I care. That's what Jesus cares. You see, the beauty about it, when you pick up a homeless man under the bridge and you start to walk with that man, you start to coach this man, eventually 5-10 years on the track, that man becomes a multi-millionaire. Now that's a story. Am I right to say that? Why pick up a businessman who's already successful to make it more success? Not there's anything wrong with it, you can do it. But the story of Jesus is, when someone is sleeping under the bridge, Narrows Bridge in Perth, and comes out of it, you walk with that man. One day, you know, his entire beard, everything stinks and smells. And eventually he gets shaved. Eventually his shirt changes. His shoes changes. He owns a business. He rides. And now he has got 45 people working. And now he's become a successful millionaire. Now that is a story. That is my Jesus. And I don't believe in prosperity doctrine. I believe this doctrine: seek ye my kingdom first, and all in its righteousness, it shall be added unto you. Don't chase mammon. Don't chase money. Chase God. When you chase God, finances will come through. Cars will be parked right in the front. You've got nothing to worry about. This is the heart of God. Staying true to the anointing of God. Don't compromise the anointing. Don't take the anointing out of God. And so here we find over here, but the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, that you do not need anyone to teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things, it's true and it's not a lie, just as it's taught you, it will abide in him. Can I also bring a moderation on this topic? If you're a young born-again believer, don't expect immediately to receive all the above. Some people are 2-3 months Christian. They will come, Pastor Rich, I've got a word for you. Way. I say, can I pray for you? Yeah, you can pray for me. Thus says the Lord, the canoes are going. From the canoes are the hibiscus. From the hibiscus there's a moon. From the moon I'm going to India. From India I'm going to go to Japan. This thus says the Lord. Happens a lot in this church. That's why most pastors in this city do not want to have prophetic churches. Joel will tell you that. Prophetic churches are very hard to maintain. 2 days, Christian will become a prophet already. Aiden will tell you, there's a prophet over here. He's 23 years of age. He calls himself a prophet. In fact, he doesn't call himself a prophet. He calls himself as an apostle. How old is he? 23 years of age, apostle. That's why most churches do not want to start up prophetic churches, because prophetic churches are loopy loops. You get a lot of loopies, or better known in our context, fruitcakes. And so, you know, straight away, who do you think? In 3 days, 3 months, Christian will say, can I pray for you, Pastor Rich? I said, okay, all right. And he'll pray. Thus says God, thus says that, and thus says that. My God says to me, everything he said is absolutely, completely not under the anointing. It comes from the flesh nature. So can I bring moderation to this topic? But the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone to teach you. This part will happen when you love your husband, when you love your wife, when you love your children, when you love your pastor, when you obey your power, when you obey the elders of the church, when you're doing the right thing, when you've gone through, when God has brought you through the ringer, when God has actually put you through trials, through tests, through furnaces, through circumstances, all of the above. Then I can tell you right now, the anointing that you've got, God teaches you.
A lot of young people will say, a lot of middle-aged people, they've just become born again. Pastor H, you don't have to tell me, that's the lady I'm going to get married. I said, how do you know? Because I saw in the spirit. Is it in the spirit or is it in what we call lust? God, I'll ask God, God, is this a lady? No, no. He's going for the girl because he's got lust after her. So some young men and women will get married. Pastor Rich, this is what God said to me. This is how. So God has spoken. Yeah, 6 months on the track, they say the marriage is about to collapse. That's not God. That's lust. So there is a, you know, when you look at verse 27, there are some pain and agony you have to go through. Anointing does not come cheap as chips. It comes with a lot of, you know, for you to walk in and for you to, you know, walk in the realm of the Spirit of God. And sometimes you'll get insulted. Sometimes you'll get thrown at. And all of the above, you'll go through that. And eventually your heart breaks. You see, all of you guys will love lavender. Am I right to say? When you look at lavender, you say, oh, it's a nice plant. But you can't smell the lavender until you pull a leaf. And then you crush the leaf as much as you can. And then you can smell it. So God will use you like a chamois and will squeeze you out. Then you can get verse 27. Until then, verse 27 will not be applied. I pray it makes sense to you guys. I've been walking in the valley for a long time, 30 years in this ministry. And it's not easy. Some people say, Pastor H, why am I going through trial? Why am I going through this suffering? Why am I going through this accusation? Why am I going through this? Because he's trying to deepen you. He will not take you into heaven until he has deepened you. If you look through the entire Bible, every man, every woman goes through trials. Every man, every woman goes through circumstance. Eventually, they get carried in the realm of the Spirit of God. But you pay a price. Anointing is not easy to come. That's why I'm saying to you, if you are tested and if you are trialed by fire, it's a good place. Because then you'll appreciate the anointing right to the end. You'll always keep the anointing in a precious way. Thank you, Jesus, for this anointing. Thank you, Jesus. I don't take granted in any place I go to and pray for people because of the test that I had to go through. Can I encourage you? Don't take God for granted. Don't take his anointing for granted. According to my device, it says I've been speaking to you 46 minutes. It even tells me. Can I finish this right at this moment? My Lord, we thank you. Close your eyes. Bow your heads. We give you praise and thanks right now for everything you've done in the presence of the Almighty God. And we thank you for the work you are doing right at this moment. We want to open our hearts. We want to open our spirits. And we want to surrender our hearts and we want to surrender our spirit, God, knowing, realizing that you are the final authority in our personal life right now. If there's anyone who's sitting over here, you do not know Jesus Christ as first time. People who have already put their hands yesterday, people who have put hands on Saturday and Sunday up, you don't have to put that again and again. You only have to do only once. If there's anyone who's here who's saying, I want Jesus as my Lord and personal Savior for the first time. I have got sin. I feel guilty. I'm not good enough. I've tried everything, but I want Jesus for the first time. I want Jesus to walk with me. If you are that person, Jesus came and died on the cross of Calvary. And on the third day, he is resurrected out of his precious blood. You and I have been set free. Bible says that he actually appears to over 500 people in the book of Corinthians. Now, Bible also says in the book of Hebrews, he does not sit. He is no longer with us. He sits on the right-hand side of the Father up in heaven right now. Although scripture also records for me that you and I will not be left alone. I'm going to send someone special. And that someone special is the Holy Spirit. If you are that person and you're saying, hey Rich, I want to give a go for Jesus to live in my life. If you are that person and you're saying, I want Jesus for the first time, not second, not third, not fourth time, first time, please put your hands up, your left hand or your right hand up in the air. Very first time you're doing. Is there anyone over here that you do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and personal Savior? Anyone? Very quick. If there's none, I'm going to close this entire service in prayer. My Jesus, we give you praise and thanks right now. You'll honor, you'll bless, you'll touch God. You'll anoint, God, these people, and you'll raise them up, God, for the purposes of the kingdom of God. Release this blessing, God, I see, God. In Jesus' name, all God's people say, amen. Can I say this?
You are faithful and you're true. Through your mercy I'm made new. I will be still and know that you are God. You're my refuge and my strength, my redeemer and my friend. With all my heart, I trust in you. You are faithful and you're true. Through your mercy I'm made new. I will be still and know that you are God. You're my refuge and my strength, my redeemer and my friend. With all my